morning. Good morning. Let's pray the prayer for illumination together. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Scripture lesson this morning is taken from the book of Philippians, chapter 4, verses 10 to 14. Reading from the New International Version. Thanks for their gifts. Verse 10. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. Verse 12, I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Yet it was good of you to share in my troubles. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Father, even as we come to you this morning, Lord, to dwell upon your word, we ask and pray that you open our hearts, open our ears, and open our eyes, Lord. That even as we plow deeper into your scripture, that will be meaningful to our lives in the year 2017. And may we learn how to rely on you, on your strength, just as Paul did. We thank you and praise you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Just about 15 days ago, we came here on 31st night to renew our covenant on New Year's Eve Watch Night Covenant service. And I'm sure, being a normal person like us, including myself, every time when we come for the covenant service, we choose to thank God, some of us for God, learn to appreciate what God has done for us. And also we are concerned, you know, as we compare the year that has gone, we tend to compare or be anxious. What is in store for us in the coming year, in 2017? Well, 2 weeks has passed, and we are now in 2017. People outside there, what will they be doing? For us, we come to church, we pray and ask God, you know, to bless us even more. Nothing wrong. But in people out there, you know, one of the things that kept popping up in my Facebook page was this stars and horoscope. And for those people who believe in horoscope and in feng shui, you'll notice that Joey Yap has also come out with a so-called list of fortune telling, or to know what your stars says. It's entitled Joey Yap's 2017 Animal Signs Outlook. And yesterday evening, as I was also going through my work, then I managed to have a short break. I also noticed that in Hong Kong, there's also another feng shui master. I forgot his name. I think it's Mark Ling. At first, I thought he's a preacher, Fu Chao preacher from either Sitiawan or Cebu, but actually, he's a feng shui master. But for us, as Christians, as believers, what can we do in the new year? How can we handle our new year that we are in right now? What we have missed out last year, what we have not done last year, the challenges that we have faced last year, this year, how are we going to handle? And one of the portions that always stirs my heart during the covenant service is, please allow me to read to you the prayer, yeah? Lord, make me what you will, I put myself fully into your hands. Put me to doing, listen, put me to doing, put me to suffering. Let me be employed for you or laid aside for you. Let me be full. Let me be empty. Let me have all things. Let me have nothing. I freely and with a willing heart give it all to your pleasure and disposal. A very meaningful prayer, but quite a difficult prayer to actually execute throughout the year. You see, Paul, even as he wrote this letter to the Philippian church, in fact, the Philippian church is one of the earliest churches that Paul set up. Yeah? It is a letter from prison. But even though it was a letter from prison, Paul has this theme of joy and happiness as a major, one of the major themes in the book of Philippians. For us, in our normal mind, we will think Paul ada sikit-sikit gila, yeah? Inside the jail also can be happy, can be joyful, can be thankful. How many of us, when we get caught and go into jail, and we can say, thank God for putting me in jail. The only thing that I can think of if you say thank you to God for being in jail is that you get free makan in jail. But not so in Paul's time, yeah? You will have to find your own food and your own clothing. Now we are more fortunate. If you are in jail, we got free makan and we got free uniform. Yeah? Of course, we also have free toilet in the jail. So we can be thankful in case we get arrested and go to jail. Yeah, this letter was written somewhere around AD 61. And in this context, Paul is saying thank you to the Philippian church for being with him, for bringing him some gifts through one of the church members named Epaphroditus. And it also has the topic of being content. But if you look at our definition, today's definition of being of contentment, of being content, we tend to think that, yeah, I'm not saying that it's wrong. We have that kind of notion that, yeah, to be content, yeah, I'm satisfied. Or I'm very willing, really, okay? There's a kind of satisfaction, like everything is complete, I have everything. Yeah, you just feel, yeah, I'm okay. Sometimes it's quite difficult to be content, especially in a new year, as we reflect what has happened last year. We either work very, very much harder or we become lazier. But even as we feel contented at times, let us begin our year differently in 2017. Maybe we can begin the year like Paul, yeah, being appreciative and thankful for what we have. I'm sure many of us in 2016, we have had a lot of good things that happened in our lives. Of course, we may have one or two challenges or suffering. And like I said, Paul was thankful for the gifts. So maybe it was an encouragement for him. But he specifically said that, I'm writing not because to solicit for funds or more gifts, but it's an expression of his thankfulness to God. It was an appreciation to God as well as to the church in Philippians. Yes, part of the gifts consisted of money and also other physical things which Paul needed, especially in the times like Paul. During the Roman Greco time, the prisoners do not have food provided for them by the authorities. They do not have clothing like what we have in Malaysia. So, even though he was appreciative, even though he was happy with the gifts, but he qualifies his thanksgiving by saying that he really did not need them and did not seek them. He did not want the Philippian church to think that, yeah, he was waiting for the gifts or he was doing all this work just to preach the gospel for the sake of money or for the sake of receiving many more gifts. But he was rather saying that he has learned the secret of contentment with the outward circumstances, whether he had little or he had much. See, during the New Year's Communion service, when we prayed that prayer, are we aware that in the event that we are really left with nothing, how are we going to handle year 2017? 7. Paul knew, Paul understood that God, our Lord, will not fail him, will not fail to give, and will not fail to supply what was necessary to strengthen him. And because of that, Paul is able to face every situation. And the key word here in this short passage is actually content. In Greek, it's from the Greek word eutaches. It's slightly different from what we normally perceive contentment. Yeah, being satisfied, being okay. But in this context, it also carries the meaning of being self-sufficient. In the sense that it is like being detached from the outward circumstances. Whatever happens outside, rain or shine, got food or no food, whatever the circumstances outside may be, we have the resources to face all these situations. It's like being on an island. Yeah, you're cut off everything, but yet God provides food through the fruit trees, through the waterfall, through a deer that will just pass by in front of you, whatever it may be. God is there. God will provide. And that is the kind of context that Paul is saying, that he's being self-sufficient, even though he was in such a dire state. And the word is actually very important to the Stoic school of philosophy that believes that this is the highest point in life where they are actually able to be completely self-sufficient. So it's an achievement for people who believes in that philosophy. Paul was not content, not because he did not need anything. Of course, he needed food. He needed clothing. But because he was self-sufficient, and the main point is that he was utterly, totally, 100% dependent on God, who gave him everything that he truly needed. That is the difference between that contentment in Paul's situation and the normal contentment which we always have the idea. Paul uses the word in the context of being independent of circumstances, but his all-sufficient resources were, he said, through Christ who strengthens him, through Christ that lives in him. How far we know about the secret of contentment in our lives, and to what degree can we say that, yeah, I'm also self-sufficient, you know, I believe that God will provide all my needs? Can we be like Paul in the event that we are left with nothing, we are left with zero? Yeah. Paul could be content even in prison. Because why? Another reason is that he knows that whatever work that he has done, the gospel is still being preached, Philippians 1:12. So when we are discontent or discontented, what is our source of origin? Paul was happy because the work that he has done, the gospel is still being preached, even though he was in jail. But for us, when we feel discontented, we are not contented enough, what is the source or the origin of our discontentment? Is it because that we feel so sad, we are discontented that, oh, today I've not been able to share someone about the gospel. Today I've not able to pray for someone who is sick. Today I've not been able to give my money to someone who is in need. Or is it because you are so angry, you're discontented because tonight is members card for JustGo sale and you line up and the money bag is in it? What is the source of discontentment? Are we able to really live just as Paul lived? We need, friends, it's always good to be like Paul. In whatever circumstances, learn to appreciate God. Learn to thank God for whatever circumstances. It may not be easy, but we have to try. Maybe we can be contented when we have, in this context, when we have three things right. Okay? The first one is perspective. Paul was able to view life from the point of view from God, God's point of view. He was able to see that he had a mission to share the gospel, to preach. And for us, what is the mission that God has given us? Can we carry on our lives looking at God's perspective? What has God in store for us? Paul was very clear. His mission was to be an apostle, to share the gospel of Jesus in any circumstances, even to the extent of being imprisoned. imprisonment. And he was prepared to do all this, even though he knows the consequences. And many of us, I suppose, we know in our hearts what is God's will for us, what we need to be doing. But yet, at times, we choose not to see all these things, the task that has been given to us, looking through God's perspective and looking through the eyes and the lenses of God. Because Paul was able to have the correct perspective, he was able to be appreciative, thankful, and even to undergo such severe challenges and trials. I think one of the earliest examples that we can see on rather mistake made by someone who lost perspective or who do not see things from God's point of view, from God's perspective, is I think our first ancestor, yeah, Eve. See, when Eve was approached by Satan in the Garden of Eden, you see, Satan is very smart, you know. He actually used the feeling of contentment in Eve's heart to shift Eve's focus, to shift Eve's perspective away from God. What Satan did was to shift Eve's focus over what God has provided, about what God has done. Now, there are so many other trees and different kinds of food for Eve to eat, yet Satan was able to shift Eve's focus from the perspective that God has given us or that she had earlier. She accepted Satan's viewpoint without checking or forgetting to see on the perspective of God. She had so many other things, but yet she wanted to have the one thing which she did not have, or which God said that you should not have. Friends, all of us are like that. We fail to see what we have, but instead we focus on what we do not have. We fail to see what we have, or paraphrase it, we fail to see what God has blessed us with, but instead we focus on what we don't have, or what God does not want us to have, and we work so hard and we crave for it. Yeah. And because we are all descendants of Adam and Eve, there is still that kind of desire in our hearts. We are prone to the sinful nature because we are all human beings. In our normal self, we want more and more and more. And especially so, the things that we don't have. I'm not just talking about money or riches or blessings per se. Yeah? Sometimes we also hear people complaining about, yala, my children like this, they're not as clever as Kompeng's children. You know, you see in Facebook splash all over Kompeng's daughters doing so well. Yeah, my son, hopeless or no, like that, you know, cannot get good results. You know, we always fail to see what God has blessed us. Whether our child is good in his or her studies, we can still be thankful and appreciative because there are so many childless couples around who don't have children. Yeah? Single person may have other giftings as well. Even though in our singlehood, we can still enjoy. Yeah? We have our friends, we have our family members, we can still enjoy. Sometimes the things that we focus on are the things that God does not want us to have. Who knows? If we get married, we'll be in trouble, even greater trouble. Yeah? We do not know. So maybe God does not want us to have a family. The point I'm trying to say is that we always fail to see what we have, but instead focus on what we do not have. Exodus 20:17 reminds us that you shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male or female servant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. And ultimately, sometimes when we are just focusing on what we don't have, we tend to covet the things which we do not have. And covet, as I look at the definition, is actually the uncontrolled desire to acquire. You know, you cannot control yourself. You just want to buy, you just want to acquire and acquire and acquire. In the 90s, you know, when Tun Daim Zainuddin was the finance minister, stock market was up in the early 90s. I think Michael and Tina will know, yeah? Early 90s, Idris from 20 cent went up to $4.5, $4.75, $5.25. Why? There was a spree of acquisition. Whenever the name, it's Daim's counter, it's Anwar's counter, or whoever's counter, everybody rushes in. Everybody keeps on acquiring, from one acquisition to another acquisition. But in the Hebrew language, the word convert, I'm going to demonstrate to you convert, yeah, but don't laugh, okay? The word actually is panting. You know how when the dog, when a dog is after something, yeah, Tina is showing. So just imagine, if Danny is coveting for Kaichu's gold watch, I just go near him and looking for his gold watch, whatever watch he may be having, it's not gold watch. Kaichu is very simple man. He has a simple 5 ringgit watch from Bunga Raya, okay? So if I just wanted to help, or just imagine I'm looking at somebody's wife and getting excited. That is the Hebrew meaning of, that means we are chase for the thing, convert the thing. We are painting, like we're so excited. And the Greek description of this convert is hold tightly. We grab something. Yeah, when I have Sean's wallet, okay. Wow, a lot of money, man. Don't play, lawyer. Look, what CIMB, I grab, you know. Covered. So when we covered for things, it's actually sinful. And God knows that it is so sinful. That is why it's listed as one of the 10 commandments. And after we covered, when we look at it, sometimes it could also because of our greed, yeah? Luke 12:15 reminds us that then he said to them, watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possession. Greed is another thing that we have to be careful of. You know, why we want to accumulate things? Why? Simple illustration, even sometimes our house, we've got a lot of tissue paper. But when we go shopping, we just keep on buying and buying and buying. For what? Correct or not? I'm not so sure how many of you all have gone to places where there's no tissue paper, but Malaysia, we do not have a problem of toilet. So we don't need to go and rush and buy tissue paper. If you're in Nepal or you're in Bhutan, maybe, you know. But in Malaysia, we've got no problem with water supply, we've got no problem with tissue paper. So why we keep on accumulating tissue paper when there's a sale? Yeah? And our storeroom is so full of tissue papers, which sometimes we don't use. We just love to accumulate because it's cheap, and because of greed, we just buy and buy and buy. We accumulate. And it's not just accumulating tissue paper. Some of us, we like to accumulate titles. Yeah? Maybe we have PBM, Pingat Bakti Masyarakat, or maybe BKT or PPN. They're not enough. Then say, how come Governor of Melaka never give me Datuk? Then got Datuk, we want Datuk Sri. There was one morning when we went for our morning walk on Saturday at Dataran Palawan, one of my schoolmates, my senior, actually, we were just talking, yeah, long time no see, this, that. You see, we were in the band together. I was a guitarist and singer, and he was also a guitarist. Then he asked where I am now. I said, yeah, I'm still in Wesley Church as an assistant pastor and doing some youth work, youth ministry. He said, I'm also doing this and that. So he took out his card. So in his card, the name is Datuk, D-A, I'm not so sure, whether T-U-K or T-O. But he was explaining to me that his Datuk is somehow different from the other Datuks, whether one is state, one is federal, because I'm not a grandfather and I'm also not a Datuk. So it didn't register in my mind. And then he says, 2 months time during the Sultan of Pahang's birthday, I'm going to get another datuk that is even higher than this datuk that I have, and he already has JP. So the thought that came to my mind, ayo, why is it so important for us to? I'm not saying that it's wrong lah, but to some people it's very, very nice to accumulate all these titles. Yeah, just keep on accumulating more and more pangkat. At the end of the day, I do not know for what. Anyway, when I went back to office that morning, I said, yeah lah, my friend got datuk. His is by the Pahang Sultan, if you ever guess it. Mine is higher. I've been knighted by Queen Elizabeth. Why? Because my BB boys and my tuition students call me Sir Danny. Isn't it higher? Huh? Sir. Sir Danny, when they see me, good morning, sir. Sir Danny, Sir Danny. Of course, it's a different context. But anyway, I feel good because I know that I have a sir from Queen Elizabeth. Of course, it's imaginary. Yeah, that's a joke. Okay? At the end of the day, when we have all this, what is it for? Is it important to God's eyes? Is it important to the perspective of God's lenses? See, we're able to get our perspective right, able to see things from God. Even when we go through challenges like Paul, you know, for example, if you're working and you have a difficult colleague, difficult working condition, but you can focus our life on God and remember that we've been placed in this company, in this family for a specific purpose, I think it'll be easier for us to be contented. People like Joseph has gone through a tough time, but he knew that God was in control of everything. The second thing that many of us land ourselves into trouble is our priorities. Yeah? Paul is a very gifted man, educated by the standards of those days, quite successful in the business in some way. And I'm sure if he were to set up his own business, whether it's a tent making or other business, he would have been a successful businessman. But Paul got his priorities right. He knew that the day when he had encountered with the Lord Jesus, he knew that his mission was to share the gospel. He knew very clearly what he needed to do, and he got his priorities right. He knew that his mission to be an apostle, to be a preacher, to be an evangelist, to preach the gospel to both the Jews and the Gentiles. Yeah, people were trying to get at him. People were trying to kill him, trying to do all sorts of things just like what Jesus went through. But he was clear and he got his priorities right. And he knew also that he had a specific time to do. We have here 2 baskets. Never mind. Later on you will know. One, the red one is for us to give extra angpao because Chinese New Year coming, right? Church tak ada duit. So the red one is for you to give angpao afterwards. And then the green one, I will tell you later. Okay, don't worry. 2 Corinthians 4:18 reminds us, so we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Yeah? What are our priorities in life? Are we doing something that is eternal, or are we doing something that is temporal? We always said, whenever we have money, when we want to invest, don't invest everything in one basket. Yeah? It's quite dangerous. You know, I've got my money, all I buy one particular counter. Okay, Carlsberg cannot buy, eh? Sinful. Eh? Okay, what counter is not... maybe like whatever counter like the I've lost touch. Okay, a trading company, and then we have some in finance. Yeah, then we have some more counters in maybe construction. In case a construction boom, at least we make some money. We have always been told or advised not to invest everything in one basket. Yeah, have some in bonds, some stock market, some in cash, some in fixed deposit. Property, a mixture, buy one condo in KL, buy one single story terrace house in Cheng, because Malacca property won't go up so much, right? So buy a small house in Malacca. We have always been told to not to invest everything that we have in one basket. But from the viewpoint of the Bible, I think we need to be clear. We have only two: unseen and eternal, seen and temporal. So let's say if you have money, let's say we have excess money, whether we're going to put our ringgit now tak laku, so I it's imaginary lah. I have a lot of US dollars. Whether I put in this basket or I put in this basket, I've got a lot of British pounds. Where should I put my money? Something temporary or eternal, whichever. Yeah? What is our focus? When we invest correctly, I think the rewards will be great. It's not talking only about money, yeah? When we set our eyes on what is eternal, we will be doing things that brings eternal results. For example, there is a sick member in our church. Maybe a single man or a single lady. Yeah? Do something to care for her. Cook a bowl of porridge. Do something. Invest your time. Invest your money. That will bring some fruits that are more eternal. Or are we just going to invest something that is more temporary? Yeah, our portfolio may increase, but whatever that we have will just be temporary. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that you cannot invest. I'm just saying that we have a choice, and don't put everything you have in one basket, like I've said. So when you have time, yeah, spend some time investing. Spend some time looking at which bank gives you the best interest rate. But don't forget that you also need to spend some time on the things that are unseen and things that are more eternal. You can have plenty of money, you can have a lot of things, and our investments are going very well. But if you don't serve God at all, you are only busy making money, busy making money, busy making money, you got no time to even visit someone who is in hospital. You don't even have time to be a backup singer. We don't even have time to help the church in our sound system. Then I think we need to review how we invest our time and how we invest in our giftings that God has given unto us. Yeah? And don't wait too long, because I think God has given all of us a specific time to do what is required. So with that short time, what are our priorities? Are we going to do more things that are more lasting, more eternal? Or are we going to carry on doing the things that don't last forever? In year 2016, many of us have worked hard, which is good. Otherwise, we'll be very lazy people, finding money, making ends meet. Some, God has blessed us more abundantly. Yeah, work is good and work is required. Otherwise, we'll get Alzheimer's very early also. But what I'm saying is that we need to prioritize our time. Whatever that we have been doing, continue doing. But do spare some time to spare things that are more eternal and more everlasting. And normally these things are unseen. You see, when you spend your time talking to a young boy from a broken family, it goes down a long way. When you impact his life or her life, 5 years, 10 years down the road, you have changed one life. When we spend our money, or when we spend our time making money, I'm not saying it's wrong, but this money, at the end of the day, when we go off, somebody else will help us to spend. Yeah, there's a saying that when we are young, we earn all the money that we could. Nothing wrong. Okay? When we are young, we earn all the money that we could. And then when we are old, we spend all the money that we could or should. How do we spend our money? paying hospital bills. Why? Because we do not prioritize. You see, when we overwork or when we lose our focus and when our priorities are not right, a lot of things can go wrong. We are so stressed out. You know, we are so tired physically. Proverbs 23:4 reminds us, do not wear yourself out. The verse never said don't work. It only says that do not wear yourself out to get rich. We must work. Okay? Do not trust your own cleverness. Many of us depend on our own wisdom, on our own physical strength to get what we aspire to get. And I think, looking at Paul's situation, a better way to get what we need is to rely on the correct source of power. Our point three, to rely on the correct source of power. Our phone batteries, we need power, yeah? When we buy a cheap imitation battery, it does not last long. But when we have a good, slightly more expensive original battery, then it lasts longer. When we have a direct access to the electricity from our home, then the battery is charged even faster and better. So our source of power, like Paul, should be God and not on all these things. Yeah? We should not rely on our strength, our own physical strength, our own wisdom, but to rely on the power of the Holy Spirit, to rely on God for total strength and power. And like Paul, he did not look at the circumstances to feel sad or what, but he relied 100% on God because he knew as a child of God, God will provide. Sometimes we need to just say a simple prayer to ask God to give us the strength to detach from the earthly ones. Maybe we need God to help us get our focus right. Ask God to help us set our priorities right. And then we'll be able to confidently say that we can utterly rely everything on God and God alone. Over in 2016, a few of us, may have had different challenges. Maybe we have waited for a promotion, but instead of promotion, the company has given you a VSS, or even got demoted, or even lose your job. And we grumble and complain about the things that has happened, instead of relying on God for power, for strength. Maybe we didn't get a big contract, but we got a small contract. And we get angry with ourselves. In situations like this, like Paul, when he had nothing, are we able to still be composed, still be confident, be so cool, like in the words found in 2 Corinthians 12:9? But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. For my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness so that Christ's power may rest in me. When we are out of job, when we have so much challenges, are we able to still be able to have that peace, that joy that surpasses all understanding, to say, yeah, God, your power has been made perfect in my weakness, in my challenges, in my situation. And because of you, because of your grace, which is sufficient for me, I can go through all these challenges. God, I rely totally on your power that rests on me. And in all my insufficiencies, in all my weaknesses, I can still recite, I can still say, I can still declare this verse meaningfully from our hearts. Friends, learn to detach from the non-essentials and concentrate on the eternal, the essentials. Paul managed to detach himself because he got his perspective correct. You know, he got his priorities right and he relied on the correct source of power. Philippians 4:19, and my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of His glory in Christ Jesus. Many of us make mistakes on relying on the wrong source of power. We rely on ourselves, our physical strength, our time, our talent. But remember that God, who knows best, He will be able to provide us with a better way, provided we are able to rely on Him as our source of power. Friends, this morning, let us be reminded once again that true contentment comes from the correct perspective that we see. Two, priorities that we set. Thirdly, the power that we rely on, which is God. Rely on God's promises. Ask God to remove these desires of wanting more and more, of working so hard. Hopefully, we don't drop dead before we actually ask God to help us, yeah? Before we start relying on God for power. Rely on God for totally, for all things, and be confident that God will supply all of our needs. How can we be content in year 2017? Can we rely fully on God instead of relying on other things? Can we carry on life even though we are facing challenges or going to face challenges in the coming year? Friends, whatever the feng shui master may say, whatever the horoscope may say about us, let us remember that God is able to supply all of our needs. And may all of us strive to make year 2017 a better year for all of us, so that indeed we may lead a triumphant Christian life in this new year. Let us pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this morning. We ask and pray, Lord, that we can, even as we look at the life of Paul, that you will help us, build us up, Lord, that we might be able to rely on you and you alone, so that even as we walk through the year 2017, we'll be able to have the correct perspective. We'll be able to prioritize our time, our talents, the things that you have blessed us with, and that we are also able to rely on you as our source of power. Help us, Lord, to rely on you in year 2017. We ask and pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.